If he does kiss you before the sun sets on the third day, you'll remain human permanently.
Hi, guys. As the title of the video says, today I'm going to take a close look at The Little Mermaid, both Andersen's fairy tale and its Disney adaptation. I'll examine how Ariel's transformation works in both versions while discussing the thematic relevance of transformation and the symbolism behind it. One, definition. Before starting to look into The Little Mermaid, it is useful to see how transformation works as a theme in fairy tales. Stepping into the territory of European fairy tales, it's clear that transformation figures largely, and it usually functions like this. An external or in some way visible transformation leads either to internal change, an inner transformation, or maturation, see Beauty and the Beast, or a change in social status, like Cinderella. In both cases, transformation secures a happy ending for our heroes. There is a sense of cause and effect. Transformation leads to change, which in turn brings happiness. However, are there any instances where transformation functions differently? In her book, Fantastic Metamorphoses, Other Worlds, scholar and novelist Marina Werner offers an altogether different interpretation of transformation while discussing Ovid's Metamorphoses, a flattering collection of ancient Greek and Roman myths. According to Werner, transformation should not always be perceived as a symbol of change, but as the means to achieve the perfect physical manifestation of a subject's inner identity. The subjects achieve final personality in this new form. From the perspective of creation, the shape into which they shift more fully expresses them and perfects them than their first form. In other words, transformation does not necessarily lead to change, but on the contrary, it results in a perfect match between someone's identity / special features and their physical / material form. To give you an example from Ovid here, I'm taking the myth of Arachne. It goes like this. Arachne was excellent at weaving, and after boasting about it and challenging the goddess Athena to a weaving contest, Athena turned her into a spider as punishment. Here, Arachne does not change after her transformation, nor does she need to, because her new form seems to serve and express her to the fullest by allowing her to infinitely do what she's best at, weave webs. So to briefly recap, we've seen transformation as the instrument either leading to change or to a perfect match between the inside and the outside. 2. Deconstruction. In Hans Christian Andersen's The Little Mermaid, there is an interesting meditation on the theme of transformation as leading to change. Although this is not addressed in the Disney film, in Andersen's fairy tale, the main motivation for the Little Mermaid to undergo an external transformation is her wish to attain an immortal human soul, which mermaids lack. Sure, she's still head over heels for the prince, but even her love for him is viewed as a manifestation of a greater desire on her part to be human. In the book, the Little Mermaid's grandmother tells her that there is one way for her to get a human soul. Only if a human loved you so much with all his heart and soul, then his soul would glide into your body, and you too would obtain a share of human happiness. Notice that the Little Mermaid's grandmother tells her that getting a human soul results in happiness. So the Little Mermaid quickly makes the assumption that transforming into a human will bring her happiness. This is why she goes to the seaweeds, who, may I note, in this version doesn't serve as the antagonist and does not manipulate Ariel. Quite the opposite, she warns Ariel that I know exactly what you're after, how stupid of you, but you shall have your way, and it will bring you misfortune, my pretty princess. You want to get rid of your fishtail, and in its place have a couple of stumps to walk on, like a human being, so that the young prince will fall in love with you, and you can win an immortal soul. The Sea Witch is surprisingly the first to chide Ariel for conflating external transformation with happiness. But this is not altogether something that does not happen in fairy tales. We often see heroes getting their happy endings thanks to transformation. So why would we assume anything else for Ariel? And that is simultaneously the greatness and tragedy of Andersen's The Little Mermaid. Despite getting an external and quite painful transformation, she does not get the prince, or love, or happiness. She just dissolves into foam and dies. And while this is a powerful deconstruction of the fairy tale connotation linked with transformation, the story ends with a ray of hope. After dissolving into foam, the Little Mermaid is transformed into a spirit of the air, where she is offered a second chance at getting an immortal soul. 3. Commodification. It is time to bring our analysis of transformation full circle and see how it applies to Disney's The Little Mermaid. Ariel feels like a misfit in the mermaid world, just like her literary counterpart, and they both share the same reasoning behind wanting to undergo an external transformation. They think that this will bring them love in the end of the day. However, the context behind this reasoning is way different. Whereas in the book, it was the Little Mermaid's benevolent grandmother who gave her the idea. In the film, this way of thinking is implicitly fed to Ariel by Ursula and her minions.
We represent someone who can make all your dreams come true. You and your prince together.
Whereas the Sea Witch in Andersen's version was upfront with Ariel about the transformation not being effective enough to win the prince's love, Ursula does the opposite. She manipulates Ariel by suggesting that getting a human body is the only way she can win Eric's love. In this version, Ursula is turned into a kind of seller, and what she sells is fantasy. And not just any fantasy. In a quite metafictional way, she literally sells Ariel, the fairy tale connotation of transformation.
The only way to get what you want is to become a human yourself.
And here's where commodification comes in.
Now, here's the deal.
Ursula effectively turns the prevalent theme surrounding transformation in fairy tales into a commodity for sale and puts a price on Ariel's abstract wishes and fantasies, promising to make them come true, when in fact, the only actual product she can give to Ariel is human legs and not love. However, Ursula is not the first to do that. Let's not forget that more than 150 years separate Andersen's fairy tale from the Disney film. And when The Little Mermaid was released, we were familiar with something Andersen's contemporaries were not: the commodification of fantasy and the media. On advertising's commodification of fairy tales, literary critic Jack Zives notes, "One comes across fairy tale motifs everywhere. The programmed fairy tale images sway our sensibilities in TV advertisements, such as the ones which have women transformed into Cinderellas by magically buying new dresses. Then there is the beast, turned into a magnificent hunk of a prince by shaving with the right brand of shaving cream." Let's unpack this. Firstly, Zives describes how advertisements capitalize specifically on the theme of transformation as it appears in fairy tales in order to sell their product. And secondly, the examples he uses create an interesting link between transformation and beauty. By highlighting that link, beauty products promise to give you the fantasy of transformation. And this is not very different from what Ursula does when she shows to Ariel how her magic can bring happiness and love to people. She literally says that this girl is longing to be thinner and that the guy wants to get the girl. and the help she offers is giving them desirable bodies that conform to beauty standards, suggesting that this superficial change brings some love. Indeed, during Poor Unfortunate Souls, there is a constant struggle between the body and the voice, which respectively stand in for material form and individual identity.
Zip.
But without my voice, how can I...
You'll have your looks.
Ursula constantly emphasizes the dominance of the material over the immaterial, a physical appearance and external beauty. She is quick to dismiss voice and personality as unattractive to people. I mean, she tells Ariel to not underestimate the importance of body language. In her book, From the Beast to the Blonde, Werner devotes an entire chapter to the Little Mermaid and highlights how throughout mythology and folklore, the identity of mermaids and sirens was interwoven with the seductiveness of their voices. So for Ariel to lose that is to metaphorically hand over the trait that represents her individuality for a pair of legs, which will help her blend in as a human, but ultimately make her indistinguishable from all other humans. She realizes the consequences of her choice and is disillusioned and heartbroken later on in the film. And Ariel is not the only Disney character who experiences this disillusionment about external transformation. Aladdin is quite similar to Ariel in this respect. He thinks he can buy his way into Jasmine's heart by having the genie transform him into a prince, because he believes this will result in a change in his social status. But he does not instantly win Jasmine's heart, and his transformation leads to more and more problems.
What if they find out I'm not really a prince? What if Jasmine finds out? I'd lose her.
Ariel and Aladdin fall into the same trap. They sacrifice their individuality for their outward appearance, only to find out that it is nothing but an empty cell, failing to bring them happiness. They still feel a void internally that they hoped their external transformation would solve. We could say that transformation is once again deconstructed, but I think that in these two films, transformation is instead redefined, because in the end, Ariel and Aladdin are exposed, briefly return to their previous state, and finally they get their transformation and their happy ending. So what has changed? Going full circle now, is the time to look back to what we said about transformation as the perfect physical form highlighting an individual's uniqueness. Ariel and Aladdin manage to get their happy endings only after putting their individuality above their external appearance, and ironically enough, it is by emphasizing what makes them special that they get the external transformation they always wanted. Here's Werner once again. It is the voice that is more powerful than beauty or even goodness. Only when the cell shatters and the Little Mermaid's voice is spirited back to her throat does she prevail and win. In this version, human shape and love of the prince. And that is why Ariel can only find perfection and happiness after she reclaims her identity. Only when Ariel and Aladdin embrace their individuality can their external transformations acquire meaning, Ariel as a human and Aladdin as a prince. So what's the takeaway? Transformation in fairy tales can either symbolize change or be perceived as the perfect outer expression of an individual's inner identity. Examining Andersen's The Little Mermaid, we saw that the fairy tale offers a deconstruction of the theme of transformation. In the Disney adaptation of the tale, transformation as a theme is linked with commodification. By drawing a parallel with Disney's Aladdin, I argued that both of the films have their characters explore the idea of transformation as a means to buy change and happiness, only to realize that without their individuality, a material and external change means little to nothing. Thank you very much for watching.